I have a surprise for you. A prison officer in prison. Let's talk to him. But before that, let's listen to him.
Prison is a home for everybody. I myself is an example. I was once a prison officer, but circumstances brought me here. I would like to advise everybody that you should be careful of what you do, even your voice. In the Quran, God told us that we should be conscious of our private parts. That is your tongue and your private part. For they are the delicate things that can send you to hell. And we all know that prison is a hell on earth.
My brother, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, I'm fine.
A prison officer in prison. Tell us, what happened?
I was once a prison officer from 2011 until 2016.
So I would say recently, in the recent past?
Yes, at maximum security prison that I had the unfortunate incident on the 5th of August 2016 at around 7:38 a.m. in the morning. I initially went to Nankpa Psychiatric Hospital with a pulse issue, Coco. Yes, please. So there was a doctor who gave me medicine that I came, I was taking it. He said I should come back when I see any changes. So I took the medicine for almost 7-8 months. The thing stopped, but after some time, it was coming again. So that fateful morning, it was a Friday. So I said, oh, I have to go and see the doctor again for him to give me the prescription. So I bathed that morning, I dressed up in uniform, take my tea, and I bade farewell to my roommate that I'm going to hospital. By then I was on duty in the afternoon. And going to hospital, I don't know when I will come back. So I just dressed in uniform so that after the hospital, I will come to work straight. So after I finished dressing, in a hurry, I forgot of my wallet. That contained my hospital details, my money, everything. So I go to the roadside. And as an officer, you always get free meals and other things. So I got a means to the hospital junction, which I walked to the hospital. So upon getting to the hospital, I normally, for favor, we don't join the queue when we go. When you are in uniform, you just speak to one of the nurses around and they will help you to facilitate your things. So I met a nurse which was on duty and I spoke to her. She said, oh, do I have my hospital card? I said, yes. So she asked for it. In my attempt to pick my wallet, I realized that my wallet was nowhere to be found. So I left it at home. So from the hospital to the barracks, I was in the barracks, maximum barracks.
In the Cape Coast?
Yes, Cape Coast, Nankpa. When you are passing the main street, it takes a longer time. There is a shortcut. That is, we call it the bush path, which we the officers always, we used to come to the hospital and buy food. So I know that path because I've been using it. So walking to that place and walking from the hospital to the junction and picking the bush path, I could almost get half of the way. On that fateful morning, the current was 110. We're also writing their entrance exams, recruitment at the hospital. So most of the people from that town were using the bush path. So it was an opportunity for me to say, oh, let me just use that bush path since other people are around. So I picked the bush path and I was coming. Behind the maximum security prison.
So you're going for your ID card?
Yes, at the barracks. Unfortunately, my roommate, whom I bid farewell when I was leaving for hospital, he was for duty at the place I was passing. So surely I will meet him. So I'm aware that he was there. So I used the footpath. When I got to the premises of the prison, just behind, it's like this too far away, but he can see me. So I heard a gunshot. Now let me add that I'm a weapon man. I've been trained with him. We're all SWAT men. So when I heard a gunshot, I studied the direction of the sound and I realized that it's coming from the prison.
So the gunshot is coming from the prison?
Yes, the prison direction.
No, so what came into your mind? Because you hardly hear gunshots coming from the prison.
Sometimes we fire, maybe, but not in the morning. It's always in the night when we go, sometimes we find them. So I proceeded walking. When I say, hey Charlie, come over. So when he said it, I heard his voice, my roommate.
So you thought it was your roommate that fired the gunshot?
At that time, I didn't know. So my roommate called me. The place was a bit bushy. So I walked towards him. He said, oh, Charlie, are you done with your hospital? I said, no. The time I was talking to you in the room, I forgot of my wallet. So I'm rushing back to take it. He said, okay. By then, the second officer, who was also at Centre 3, was coming. And I'm the type I hardly play with people. So when I told him that I'm going for my wallet, he said, okay, okay, okay. So I walked past him. Then I met the guy, he kept his weapon, but then they were holding guns, G3 rifle. They were holding, he kept it in the right hand and he's pushing me. I told myself, Charlie, you, this guy, don't play with you. Why? He asked, why do I come and do that? So I was shocked.
Why did you come and do
that? I don't know. So I turned back and I said, what are you talking about? Why was I throwing substances into the prison yard? I said, what?
He was asking you why you were throwing substances into the prison yard.
I said, what? What are you talking about? Why would I be doing that?
What kind of substance was he talking about?
Initially, they didn't tell me. So when he pushed me and I said, oh, why? Like, I don't like that kind of thing. I'm not in playing mode with you. As you can see, I'm for late. So I have to be fast and go to work. So he tried to push me again. Out of anger, I pushed him out of my way.
Okay.
And I was walking. I picked the first, second, third. On the fourth step, the one I passed by my roommate, he cocked his weapon and squeezed the trigger.
No, I don't get it. Your roommate.
My roommate.
You even met him on the way.
I was very shocked.
You met him on the way. You spoke and then even told him that you are going for your ID card.
Yes.
And you hear a gunshot. You are accused of having thrown some substances into the prison. Yeah. Obviously drugs, I suppose.
Yes, according to
that. And then the next moment, your roommate...
squeezed his trigger. So when he squeezed it, it was a close range. So the impact was not immediately felt. So I turned back and asked, Hagan, why? I thought he missed. So when I turned back and asked him, Hagan, why? Why do you...
Did he shoot?
He shot me.
He shot you?
Yes.
How?
He can't miss. He's a weapon man. But because of the close range...
And why would he shoot you? I still don't get it.
I'm yet to find out, Master Ibrahim. So when I turned back and asked, why? Why do I attack his colleague? Attack your colleague? You just saw me pushing him away and I was going. That didn't I try before I fell down. It was there I realized that no, the ammunition actually got me.
It caught you?
Yes, on my pelvic, right. So I don't know whether it touched my blood again. So I was losing blood. So after that moment, my mind was to just be saved. So the one that pushed me, I lied down and I was holding her, begging he should call for help. So when the guy shot me, out of fear, he dropped the weapon and rushed to me. So they called our immediate commander, ASP Benedict Osei. So he came to the team. When he immediately came, he said they should lose me, they lose me. So they told him that I was throwing substances, suspected to be weak inside the prison. But then I was still conscious. He said they should search me. They searched me and removed my two phones. He asked them, is that all you get? They said yes. Two mobile phones, he said yes. Then he called for help. Mr. Ibrahim, after that time, I was begging him to send me to hospital. None of them ever showed a substance that they claim I was throwing inside to the prison to that one. So I begged for them to bring a car. And I am the second command after him, after the ASP, I'm the next senior officer. So when he's not there, I fix.
What was your rank then?
Lance Corporal.
Lance Corporal, okay.
Yes, please. And all of us were Lance Corporal, but I am their senior.
Oh, okay.
Yes. So they called for the car to come. It was there I lose consciousness. I woke up in the hospital in the evening. Actually, the police came to take my statement. When they came, they asked them to wake me up. That was in the evening. I woke up. They said they are the police from Elamina Police Station, and they are here to take my statement. I'm being charged with a possession of narcotic substances suspected to be weed. Then attempting murder.
But are you sure they did not find anything incriminating on you? They did not find any real on you, because you know it is against the law to throw, you know, PNDC Law 236 is clear that smoking, inhaling, importing narcotic substance is clearly against the law.
That's true.
So are you not sure you are in possession of something that may have triggered this reaction?
Mr. Ibrahim, had it not been after that day incident, 2 months, 2 weeks later, I've never known weed. I don't smoke.
That's fine, but there is obviously a difference between smoking.
Yes.
There are some people who indulge in narcotics. There are some people who may not have smoked before.
That's true.
But they are dealers in the trade. They are dealers.
Unfortunately, I don't even know weed. And I can swear with the Quran. You know the implications of swearing with the Quran. I can do it.
Mm. And I'm sure you also know the implications of swearing with the Quran. I don't want you to swear because that should not be the focus of the interview.
Yes.
But I have to be balanced as much as possible.
That's true.
Because, so let's delve into the issue. So what happened?
So after the police came to the hospital to take my statement, they woke me up. So they, I asked, what are my charges? He said, possession of narcotic substances suspected to be weed, attempting to supply, and attempting murder.
So let's look at the attempting murder part. You have denied, possessing any narcotic substance. What about attempting to murder? Because you haven't given us the full details. You said you pushed someone out of your way, and then the next minute you were shot at. And so tell us more. Did you maybe overreact? Because if you were shot at, or if the circumstance, or you don't think the circumstances around that time may have warranted, you know, a fierce reaction from you?
Mr. Ibrahim, these are two officers that has undergone the same physical and mental with weapon training with me. No difference. They know the level of weapon I can handle, although maybe one may be better than the other. But when it comes to physical combat, they know my status, they know their status. I could not have possibly overpowered it all.
What is your status in physical combat?
My colleague cannot put me down.
So what eventually happened? The police took your statement?
That day I didn't give them the statement.
Why?
So I was shocked because it's the same evening. So I told them that I need to talk to my family. So the police actually told me that she's having my phones, but they are under investigations. So they will not release it. And I said, is that all? They said yes. I've wanted to ask, what about the narcotics? But one of the nurses told me that I don't have to talk too much, so I should rest. So they went. After they left, they told the nurses that nobody should visit me. I shouldn't receive any visits. And four officers were put on guard on me, two prison officers, two police, both from the SWAT unit.
Mm.
So I realized that having access to my family, not even talk of a counselor, was a problem.
Mm.
So 1 week later, I called them that I would like to give my statement. So I gave the statement out. Upon that, they still refused to hand over my phones to me.
Mm.
As at that time, they still didn't even show me the substances that they were charging me with. So I was in hospital for 2 months, 2 weeks.
Whilst at the hospital, what was going through your mind? Prison officers are held in high esteem. The fact that they are supposed to maintain law and order in the prisons, and then next minute, though you are in hospital, you are facing criminal charges. What was running through your mind?
A lot. Actually, I asked one of the officers, a female officer was appointed to take care of me. Nobody had access to me apart from her. I actually asked her for Pathetin, Tramadol injection. You know, we can miss those things to cause suicide.
Wanted to commit suicide?
I was
contemplating. Could that be an indication that you knew you were guilty, so you didn't want to face this embarrassment? Some people commit suicide because of the fear of facing the truth, because of the embarrassment they are likely to go through. Could that be the reason why you wanted to commit suicide?
Not really.
Then why would you want to commit suicide when you know that what you are being accused, you are innocent of what you are being accused of?
I have 3 points. Number one, I'm a single parent. I grew up with my auntie. And my auntie, she's very, 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 very strict. She don't support work. So I realized that if my auntie actually come to get off this, I'm better off dead. She won't even wait to hear my own side of the story.
She wouldn't wait to hear your own side of the story.
She's very strict. Mm-hmm. Once you are, they put it on social media that you are committed, she'll pick it from there.
Mm.
So I wasn't even thinking about the consequences. How will I face my auntie?
Mm. That was your problem?
That was my major problem.
You aren't married?
But then I had my woman that I thought was pregnant.
Mm.
And she was 4 months pregnant.
4 months pregnant?
Yes.
Were you married to her?
I did the dowry, along with the normal calling of friends to come and celebrate, according to the Islamic Sharia.
Mm. Okay, so that we don't digress from what we are talking about. So the police came, took your statements. What happened?
So after 2 months, 2 weeks, I was discharged. They took me to police custody. Then that was on Monday. Wednesday, they went to I had an information from one of the police, that is Elamina police, that with your foundation, we can't send you to court. But what we do is that we go for remand warrant, present remand warrant, so that we'll be sending you to hospital for treatment. When you are okay in the present custody, then we'll take you.
Right, before that, I forgot one thing. What made you change your mind about committing suicide?
The lady refused to give me. She actually advised me and I realized that no. She said...
Did you tell the lady you wanted to commit suicide?
Yes.
So you weren't expecting her to give you the drugs?
I'm very plain. I will tell you my... I will express myself. If you will help me, fine. If you won't. Because Allah says we should always speak the truth. If even they will kill you. Mm. And secondly, I wouldn't want to put her into problem. I have to tell her. You make your decision. So what problem come? You can defend yourself. Actually, I know what he was coming to do. So she advised me because when the thing happened, they had interviews. And they realized that like the way the interview was going on, no, this guy has a better case. So she said, no, she believed in me. So I shouldn't do that. She advised me for almost 3 days. And
okay, that's fine. So you were eventually taken to court. And then what happened in court?
I was granted bail when I was sent to court. So after the court, they took me back to the police station. It was there. Then they...
Before you were granted bail, what transpired in court? What did the judge say? Did you have a lawyer?
Yes, but when the police gave me the information, I asked him for a lawyer. He actually got me one.
And who got you a lawyer?
The police. He actually called my family to that I've been discharged from hospital. So that very evening, my family left Accra and came. They reached Cape Coast around 11, 12 in the night. Mm. So by then the lawyer was there. So they paid the lawyer. The lawyer took us 5,000. It was a hassle day, but they had to call friends and other things to organize the money. So they gave me. Then the next morning, when they sent me to hospital, but I didn't even talk because I can't even stand. I can't sit. So they had to carry me. The judge just looked at me and granted me bail. That I should go and treat myself.
Okay, so that was the basis of you being granted bail by the judge.
5,000, 5,000 or two surety.
Let's get to the D-Day. I'm more interested in that. What happened? Why are you in prison? The judge looked at the fact that you weren't well, so he quickly granted you bail. You're optimistic of winning because you claim you didn't possess any drugs and so on and so forth. So you're optimistic, and then eventually you are in jail. So how come?
Mr. Ibrahim, actually, 4 judges sat on my case. The first one was transferred when the case was about to finish. So is the second and the third. It's only the 4th judge that jailed me and one other, and she was transferred. So the first, second, third one didn't have any case. It was the 4th one that jailed me.
How many years were you given?
I was given 18 years.
18?
13.
13 years. And what was your charge?
Finally, they dropped all of them, leaving with a possession of narcotic substances suspected to be.
Yes, you have flatly denied all the accusations.
Yes,
and you want to go even swear with the Quran, which I don't subscribe to. But I've seen so many people, so many Muslims, because I am one myself, say, oh, wallahi, wallahi, I didn't do wallahi. At the end of the day, you realize that they did it. So it appears wallahi has become a refrain,
yes,
being used by so many people. You get the point?
Yes.
How do you juxtapose the wallahi that eventually leads to people admitting they have committed a crime against your wanting to swear with the Quran,
yes,
which we don't know whether you were truly in possession of narcotic drugs?
Yes. Just as I told you earlier, I always speak what I think is true. This particular crime, I didn't do it.
So how come the court was able to prove
on the,
just a minute?
Yes.
How come the court was able to prove beyond every reasonable doubt that you were in possession of narcotic drugs?
Master Ibrahim, throughout the verdict of the court, it's only one person, one witness, that has ascertained that he actually saw me hiding, sitting on top of a black bottle mark. That he suspects the substances were inside. All the other 3 have denied it.
The prison officers in there, because we were walking outside the prison, did they establish that someone had thrown weed into the yard? Were they able to establish that?
From the rumors I heard, no. But what they said in court is that one of the substances managed to get inside the prison, and the other one hit the wall, that draw the attention of that guy, so he hit. So my lawyer was trying to say, well, if one substance has entered the yard, implies my hand has already touched it, including the one that hit the wall.
Did they do any forensics? Because this happened in 2016. Did the police do any forensic examination to establish, take your fingerprints, that of the rubber bag, on the rubber bag, to establish that you may have thrown it?
What happened is that they took my fingerprints, but they refused to do the forensic test.
So then how come would a judge, I want you to tell us the truth, how come then would a judge commit you to a prison sentence when because I guess the judge may have ordered them to do forensic examination.
And that is what baffles myself and my lawyer. Even the rubber bag they claim I was sitting on, on the court day, it was not there. When I was granted bail, the CID brought two envelopes and said, oh, Mr. Abiba, I want you to sign this envelope. I'm done with your investigations. I want to put your document, send it to headquarters, so that they can, Attorney General, they can give us an advice. So I signed it. After I signed it, then she brought the substances and showed me this is what they said I was possessing. I said, well, I don't know anything. Today is my first time of seeing them. So she actually kept the substances into the brown envelope that I sent. And I was asking, madam, these are not my documents. You said you want to put my documents. You have a witness. Why are you putting these substances? She said, no, it's just for identification. So I personally asked her, are you sure you are not going to use this as an evidence against me in court? She said, no.
So you were eventually given 13 years. How was it like being given, the day you were told that you had been given 13 years in prison? How did you feel?
Since I joined the prison service, that was the first time I wept.
That was the first time you wept?
Yes.
Wept like a baby?
More than a baby. I was on my knees, praying, expecting miracle. For the judge to just look in my eyes and say, Charlie, you have regretted, go home. But it wasn't. But then my wife was in the crowd with my 1 year, 2 months baby. I don't know.
So how old have you, how many years have you spent so far?
I'm now 1 year, 1 month.
Just 1 year?
1 month.
1 month.
Yeah, that was
you have about 12 or 11 years more. Years. When you look in the, you know, back about the fact that you were a prison officer, you were guarding prisoners, you were dealing with prisoners on a daily basis, you know the harsh prison conditions, you know the congestion situation, you've ordered inmates to go and sleep, you were the boss, now you are an inmate yourself. First, how was it like when you were entering the prison yard, not as an officer this time, but as an inmate?
I told myself that what I did for prisoners, I should get an officer to do the same thing to me.
What do you mean by that?
Although I've been convicted by a crime that I'm not guilty of, there are some certain things I used to do that were not allowed by the prison service.
What were some of the things?
Taking mobile money for prisoners who normally receive money from their relatives. It was clearly outdated, but looking at the prison condition, the food and other things, I violated the laws, especially when...
You violated the laws?
Yes.
When you were a prison officer?
Yes.
But you know it was obviously against the law.
Yes.
Because you know the problems some prisoners are causing with the use of mobile phones. Some prisoners have duped the unsuspecting public. And it is the, the prison service have to guard against some of these acts that are considered illegal. So why were you breaking the laws when you knew that it was against the laws?
Mr. Ibrahim, I always try to understand the situation of that person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when you are able to give help and put a smile on the face of another person who needs your name, He will reward you more.
Absolutely. But have you also forgotten the fact that the Quran also urges us to respect constituted authority?
Yes.
And that it is not about what you think, but the laws must be adhered to.
That's right.
So is what you are saying not in complete contradiction to the teachings of the Quran?
It was. And I was left with an option. It's either I help this prison and maybe in my heart expecting a reward from Allah and knowing very well that I am committing a crime against the institution that I was.
Will I say that you are the extremist type of Muslim who go there, who do whatever it takes to get what they want, even if it is against the law, because of emotions? You are carried away by emotions most of the times. Would you agree with me?
That is true, but not relating to things I don't do. Money, yes. Oh, my brother, take this money, go and buy me food and other things. I will do it, although I know it was against the law.
Right. That's fine. Now, let's move away from there. How was it like? A prison officer, inmate. How were you received? Did they know you were once a prison? Did they know you were a prison officer?
When I came here, those prisoners who were at Ankafo before, they know me. Some shed tears. Some came out to give me encouragement.
Has your wife left you or she's going to leave you eventually?
My wife has been very supportive. Unfortunately, she's not working.
You haven't answered my question. Is she going to leave you?
No,
she's looking at you. Know her better. 13 years. Is she going to wait for you?
She's waiting for me.
She's waiting. This is only the first year.
Yes, and since I came, she always tried to come every month.
What's the name of your wife?
Hamida.
Hamida
Al Hassan.
So you give us your wife's number. We'll go and visit her.
Alhamdulillah.
Let's now go to DSP Ibrahim Yakubu. He is a prison officer. Let's ask him one or two questions about a prison officer coming into prison. How is it like?
Any natural human being would say it's very, very sad to see any other human being, not necessarily a prison officer, coming to a prison. But as the laws demands, we are here to enforce the law, to take good care of them in custody. So whether he's guilty or not guilty of the offense that he's charged of, our duty is to take good care of him, just like any other inmate. Mm. So we welcome him. We advise him to be of good behavior, and we have taken him through the system just as any other inmate.
Hmm. When you see him, anytime you see him, what comes into your mind?
Anytime I see him, what comes to my mind is that I should watch up on what I'm doing. Whether he did it, he didn't do it, I can easily find myself where he is, so I should be very careful.
Were you here when he was brought in?
Yes, please, I was here when he was brought in.
And did you know him before coming in?
No, I didn't know him. I only heard of his story.
So when you were told he's a prison officer, what was your reaction?
In fact, the first day I sighted him in the yard, in a prison jumper, I shook the head with a lot of things going through the mind. And the next thing is that, so what is the lesson, or what should I learn from it? As a prison officer. So I then know that, okay, one, the allegation that is leveled against him, whether it is true or not true, then I have to also sit back and reflect my life. Whatever the law says is no good, I shouldn't go near it. Then I will also advise other prison officers and all other security services that the law that you are enforcing, if you don't go by the law, is the same law that will be used against you. And you can find yourself in the situation that our brother has found himself.
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much. What advice do you have for the public?
Prison is the second home of everyone. Anyone can come here at any point in time. I urge everyone outside there to be mindful of what you do, if even what you are doing is to your close relative and you know very well that it's against the laws of the Constitution. Please, don't make the mistake I have made, which I am regretting right now.
So this is the story of Abibulai Nankpa, a prison officer who eventually finds himself in prison for 13 years. What does this tell us? This goes to confirm what we have been saying all the time, that no one is above the law. I can't fault him, but the judges have spoken. Nevertheless, we can only further establish the truth through an appeal. So we would want to appeal to anyone who wants to come to his aid, to come and then help him appeal the sentence.